Praise the Lord.
Once again, I want to tell you that the questions we ask, not to embarrass anybody. In case anybody feels embarrassed, please let me know. I won't ask questions to them. But just take it as this is a big family of God. So by refreshing our memory about what we studied, it will help our spiritual life. So shall we turn to Genesis chapter 40, last time we studied, chapter 43, from the first verse, the first and second verses. And the famine was sore in the land, and it came to pass when they had eaten up the corn which they had brought out of Egypt, their father said unto them, go again, buy us a little food. We learned a little thing, something about why God allows famine. We find again God allowed famine. Maybe Brother David can say, that's right, that is the reason. If God doesn't allow a famine, lacking in us, or some difficulties for us, problems, if we don't have any problems, we may not go to Him. And then the verse 3 and 5, 3 to 5, we read, and Judah spake unto him, saying, the man did solemnly protest unto us, saying, you shall not see my face except your brother be with you. If thou wilt send our brother with us, we will go down and buy thee food. But if thou wilt not send him, we will not go down. For the man said unto us, you shall not see my face except your brother be with you. Something that we learned last week out of that. Maybe that's right. Anything that we love too much and get attached to that, unless we take that out or bring like our Isaac, we put it in the altar, or as Shibu told, we have to bring our very best to Jesus. Then only we can really be blessed in the presence of God. There are some other blessing meanings also. Anyway, we will quickly go to that. Anything else anybody can remember from that text that we learned? Anybody hands up? Who can say? Yes, Brother Louis, that's right. Anything that we love more than God, yes, sir. That can be a source of fear also for us, problem also for us. That's what happened to Jacob all along. And verses 6 and 7, and Israel said, wherefore dealt you so ill with me as to tell the man whether you had yet a brother? And they said, the man asked us straightly of our state and of our kindred, is your father yet alive? Have you another brother? And we told him, according to the tenor of these words, could we certainly know that we would say, bring your brother down. Out of this, one thing that we learned last week, that Jacob, even unconsciously, unknowingly, he did not blame the governor, although he did not know that governor was Joseph. Something that we learned out of that last week, maybe, perhaps Sister Margaret can say, what is the reason? Can Sister Dawn? That's right. Yes, you are done. Yes, that's well done. So, if we really love Jesus, because Jacob really loved Joseph, we know Joseph is the type of Jesus. When we really love Jesus, even in the hardest trials and problems, we don't murmur and complain or find fault with our Jesus. And then verses 8 to 9, and Judah said unto Israel his father, send the lad with me, and we will arise and go, that we may live and not die, both we and thou, and also our little ones. I will be surety for him, of my hand shalt thou require him, if I bring him not unto thee and set him before thee, then let me bear the blame forever. Something beautiful we learned about Judah out of this. Maybe Jimmy can mention? That's right. You are done. Well done. So Judah is the one who was instrumental in selling Joseph. Judah was the one who committed sin of immorality. Judah was a terrible person. But here we find a change in Judah. So it shows, Judah's change shows, even out of Judah came Jesus Christ. So that means even the hardest people also, most difficult people also, even the people those who have fallen to so many sinful things, even sin of immorality or anything, the grace of God can change them and God can make them a real saints. Out of all the 12 tribes, God chose the tribe of Judah through whom Jesus could be born. And the 10th verse, for except we had lingered, surely now we had returned this second time. Brother Anbu, can you mention anything about this? Except we had lingered, surely now we had returned the second time. Something we learned. Yes. If they had not delayed, Simeon could not have been in so much time in the prison, and the famine time could have been shortened, and all their blessings they were waiting could not have delayed. What we learned is that sometimes the spirit of procrastination, delay, we want to do something, but we just want to delay it. Through that, we lose so many of blessings. And verses 11 to 13, and their father Israel said unto them, something we learned about Israel and Jacob also, that some places Israel mentioned, some places we find Jacob, maybe Sister Olga Primacio. Yes, most of the places in the Bible, wherever we find Israel mentioned, there is something good part of Jacob's life. Jacob, most of the time when we read, something negative or unbelieving or doubting part will be there. And last time we learned the examples in 48 chapter verse 3 and 49 verse 5. Then verses 15 to 16, and the men took that present, and they took double money in their hand, and Benjamin, and rose up and went down to Egypt and stood before Joseph. And when Joseph saw Benjamin with them, he said unto to the ruler of the house, bring these men home and slay and make ready, for these men shall dine with me at noon. Couple of things we learned. Can one of the things Sister Floor say louder? What you say is correct. Please be louder. Ah, that's right. Yes. That's beautiful. Anything else we learned, maybe Sister Ruby? Yes. Have you learned anything about at noon, Brother Philip? Yes, something more, Sister Rachel? Yes. Noon shows, when the sun is on the zenith, in the heat of the, like in Abraham we read about the heat of the day, the highest state of spiritual life. We will go to the next part of the study. I would like to remind you why I ask questions, that most of these things are connected with our how to build our own personal character. It's not only just as a lesson to study to live a higher life. I hope this will help us through this. So please listen carefully. Strictly I want to tell that out of this study, I don't want to say about the regarding Bible knowledge and geographical or historical facts and various other facts. Primarily, I want to touch only, as God gives grace, about our character. How can build up our character? So on that basis only these studies go. So I encourage all of you to continue to come and invite, if possible, others too. Verses 16 and 17. And when Joseph saw Benjamin with them, he said to the ruler of his house, bring these men home and slay and make ready, for these men shall dine with me at noon. And the man did as Joseph bade. And the man brought the men into Joseph's house. So the ruler of the house did exactly as Joseph told him. This ruler of the house can be compared to the Holy Spirit. So the man brought, that ruler of the house brought these people into Joseph's house. If Joseph is called Jesus, the meaning of Joseph is Jesus, then Joseph's house means what? Then Joseph's house means what? House of God. So nobody can come to the house of God unless the Holy Spirit draws us. So that Joseph told to the ruler of the house, and the ruler of the house brought these men to Joseph's house. One day you and I, we were brought to the house of God because Holy Spirit urged us to go to the house of God. Even some of you today perhaps may not have come had not the Holy Spirit told you. You might have been thinking, oh, I am very tired today and perhaps I can rest. Then what did the Holy Spirit say? No, get up and go. Get up and go. So here the ruler of the house brought this man. He obeyed. Actually, it is something very strange. The ruler of the house was observing. Earlier, Joseph was calling these men spies and speaking roughly. And now, Joseph is inviting them to the house and a banquet is prepared. And so this ruler could see what a change in Joseph's attitude. But still the ruler obeyed. Ruler also not only shows the Holy Spirit, the servants of God who are guided by the Holy Spirit also. What? You know that 17th verse says, and the man did as Joseph bade, and the man brought the men into Joseph's house. Because 16th verse says, bring these men home. It was not a pleading or requesting, would you like to go, come to my house? It was the command of Joseph, bring these men home. So some of us did not, we were very stubborn people. But the Holy Spirit, through the commandment of the Lord, caught hold of us and brought us to the house of God. Some of us were not willing converts. Some of us were not willing to be changed. But the grace of God has got a gentle force. That is how all of us are here. Nobody has come because we wanted to come. We all have been gently forced by the Holy Spirit. And that is why even today we are here. And the 18th verse, I would like you to note, and the men were afraid because they were brought into Joseph's house. And they said, because of the money that was retained in our sacks at the first time are we brought in, that he may seek occasion against us and fall upon us and take us for bondmen and our asses. See, the men were afraid. They were afraid to go to Joseph's house. We all were like those men first, isn't it? First, when I look to my life earlier, before I came to Pentecost, I was afraid also to go to Joseph's house. I didn't like to go to Pentecostal church. But it was Joseph's command, bring Thomas to here. Bring Anbu, bring Raymond. So a gentle force came upon us. And they were afraid. Why? They were afraid, thinking we are going to lose everything. We will lose our money, even our donkey also. That was what their fear. Now also people, those who are afraid to come to the Pentecostal church, why? They think they will lose everything. All the pleasures of the world. Oh, they think they will lose their happiness. But our Joseph has prepared a banquet there. All fatted calves have been slain and everything is made ready. Although they were afraid, later on they came. But what a shallow idea they had about Joseph. What was their fear? They were afraid because they were brought into Joseph's house, and they said, because of the money that was returned in our sacks at the first time are we brought in, that he may seek occasion against us and fall upon us and take us for bondmen and our asses. So, like these brethren, sometimes we also have got a very shallow, very wrong idea about our Joseph. And what did they say? This man is going to fall on us. He is going to seek occasion against us and fall on us. And what are they afraid of? They are going to take us as bondmen. as slaves. Why they were afraid, do you know? Why they were afraid that Joseph, this governor is, of course they didn't know it was Joseph. Why they were afraid this governor is going to take us as slaves? There is a reason. Can you say, guess? Yes, Brother David? That's right. They sold Joseph as a slave. And therefore now they are afraid they will be sold as slaves. What we sow, that we will reap. But when we reap, it will be hundredfold more. So, if you cheated somebody, you have always a fear somebody is going to cheat you. If you have deceived somebody, same thing, you are afraid, although nobody is going to do. If you persecuted or harmed anybody, you will be afraid the same will be meted out to you. We read about Cain. Cain killed his brother. Afterwards, what happened? He was always haunted by fear. Somebody is coming to kill me. In fact, not somebody. He told God, everybody is after me to kill me. Shall we read that? Genesis chapter 4, verse 14. That is very strange. Behold, thou hast driven me out this day from the face of the earth, and from thy face shall I be hid, and I shall be a fugitive and a vagabond in the earth. And it shall come to pass that everyone that findeth me shall slay me. Everyone. Actually, there were very few people on that earth now, that time. But he was afraid, I think some time ago I told, the reason was that he had killed his brother. Therefore, anybody coming towards him, or he sees, even if he doesn't see, he is afraid that he is going to kill me. So, fear of death caught him. So, in any area, suppose if you cheated somebody with your money, you have always a fear haunted, somebody is going to cheat you. And one day you are going to lose all your money. So, when there is a guilty conscience, when there is a sin unwashed in our heart, that the reflection of sin will be there in our life. That is why it's very important. We need our sins to be really forgiven and cleansed, or else this guilty feeling will be there. And what are they thinking about it? Joseph is this governor. This governor is a great governor in Egyptian empire. He was next to the king. So he was holding a great high position. And what these brethren are saying? They say that he may seek occasion against us and fall upon us and take us for bondmen and our asses. These asses, these donkeys, where are they coming from? From a famine-stricken land. So these donkeys might have been skin and bone. Because people, human beings, didn't have enough food to eat. But now what are they afraid? This governor is going to? Governor is interested in our donkeys. They were donkeys. That was the reason. How foolish they were. They could not understand the mind of Joseph. Sometimes we are like that. We don't understand how much our God loves us. And we just like these men thought, we think that the Lord is going to take away our comforts out of us, our job out of us, our health out of us, and this and that, fear comes. So, till Joseph revealed himself to them, this sort of unnecessary fears continued in their heart. Anyway, the lesson that we have to learn, once again, the same truth. If there is a guilty feeling in our life, because over 20 years their conscience has been sleeping. Over 20 years ago they sold their brother and deceived their father, telling that some wild animals might have killed your son. So over 20 years their conscience have been sleeping. Now their conscience has been really awakened. So I want you to listen this. Time and time again, God allows some problems, and that problems do not go, and you find you are in a great stress and difficulty. You know why God allows that? there are some areas in our spiritual life, in our character, still untouched. It may be your arrogance or my arrogance. It may be our pride. It may be our hot temper. It may be some stubborn nature. It may be some rebellious nature. But like 20 years, the conscience has been sleeping in your life and in my life. That unsanctified area, untouched. There are some areas in your life and in my life. Therefore, constantly God has to allow some problems to come and attack us till we open up our conscience and correct. It is like I got a wound for 20 years. I have been, covering it up without taking the pus out and without cleaning with oil. And it becomes septic. It becomes so poisonous. Similarly, in our life sometimes, there can be some sins. We don't get deliverance out of it. We keep in our heart. It may be bitterness. It may be anger. It may be some other carnal nature. And as we keep in our heart, you will find, like this brethren, this governor is after us. He is going to take us, make us as slaves. He is going to take our donkey away. And he is going to take everything out of us. You find God to be, this governor, Jesus to be a terrible man, a dictator who is frightening you, who is going to punish you. It's all, dear children of God. It's one reason. There are some areas of our life we don't allow God to touch and cleanse us. Tonight examine and see what are the areas. For maybe 20 years or more we have been Christians, born-again Christians, spiritual Christians. But we don't let the Lord touch in some areas of our life. Sometimes we become so untouchable. Therefore, God has to continue to visit us in those areas. The 19th verse, and they came near to the steward of Joseph's house, and they communed with him at the door of the house. This is what we all have to do. Before, what is the meaning of Joseph's house? To the house of God. And this steward also is a servant of God or the Holy Spirit. So before they entered into the house of God, so to say, Joseph's house, they communed with the steward. And they communed with him at the door of the house and said, "Oh sir, we came indeed down at the first time to buy food, and it came to pass, in our sack the money was found, this and that, and the other money we brought." In other words, they want to make their conscience clear before they enter into Joseph's house. Till I hope you got the clue now. Did you understand what I mean? Yes, before we enter into the house of God, we have to commune with the Holy Spirit. And our conscience has to be set right. They communed with the steward before they entered. As they came near to to Joseph's house, they communed with them. They didn't simply enter into Joseph's house. We shouldn't simply enter into the house of God. Before we enter, when we step into the house of God, as it is written, we should commune with the steward of Joseph to the Holy Spirit. Lord, am I worthy to come to the house of God? Lord, there are things in my life, Lord, I am not fit to come to your house. The things which what I thought or I spoke, I did, Lord, I have not been right. So these brethren, they communed with and told to make clear their conscience with regard to, of course, about their matter is regarding the money matters. Even sometimes it can be in money matters. We may have to be, our conscience have to be correct. Maybe some other matters also, we need our conscience to be correct. Anyway, when we come to the house of God, we should have a clear conscience and our heart should be pure. And for that, Holy Spirit only can help us. Don't expect after coming to the house of God, sitting in the chair, to ask pardon for sins and mistakes. Before we step in, prayerfully we come to the house of God. That is the best thing to do, to receive blessing in the house of God. Somebody may read verse 23. Now the steward of the house, steward, again I told you, the Holy Spirit. The steward, Joseph's servant, obviously the steward must be an Egyptian servant. See the way that this servant is greeting this, or speaking to this brethren, Joseph's brethren. Joseph's brethren told, last time when we took the corn in our sacks, when we opened it, we found the money is returned to us. So we brought the money back. So Joseph's steward told, first, peace be to you, fear not. Actually, this is the message the whole world needs. Peace be to you. People don't have peace, but they are in pieces very often. Peace be to you. Jesus also, after he was resurrected, when all the doors were closed and the disciples were afraid, Jesus came inside and told, peace be unto you. Even when Jesus was born, on the day Jesus was born, the angels sang more or less the same thing. First thing they told, fear not. That is the first word the angels used. Again the angels told, peace be, or honor peace. So Jesus brought peace. And this steward also was able to speak about peace. Listen, this brethren, have you ever seen in the past Bible studies any time this brethren speaking anything about peace or about the Lord to anyone? No. They didn't have any peace. How can they have peace who were guilty of selling Joseph or Jesus? So, such people don't have peace. But Jesus came to this world to bring peace. Peace on earth. And peace be unto you. See, the way that Joseph had taught his servants, although these are Egyptian servants, Joseph taught them. First thing about peace. When Joseph was in prison also, earlier studies we heard, when Pharaoh had the dream and the whole palace was in trouble, when Joseph was asked, the first words that he told is that God is able to, one of the first things that Joseph told was, God is able to give you an answer of peace. God will give Pharaoh an answer of peace. I want to tell you, dear children of God, one of the important signs of a child of God is peace of mind. Have you got real peace, inner peace in your heart? There can be only one problem for peace. Sins in our life. Bible says, even the end of a man should be peace. The mark of a perfect man, Bible says in Psalm 37 says, mark the perfect man. Behold the upright. The end of that man is peace. So, how do we know a perfect saint? It's very simple. Undisturbed peace will be there. How do we know people, those who are sins inside, very little things, they get troubled. Mark of a perfect man is undisturbed peace. The wicked are like the sea, which cannot rest. All the waves are rolling, and it is throwing dirt to the shore. The wicked are like the troubled sea, when it cannot rest. But mark the perfect man. Behold the upright. The end of that man is peace. Dear children of God, peace, although it is the gift of God, it can only be kept in a pure conscience. You may not have a job to go tomorrow. You may not have food to eat tonight. You may not have a roof above you to sleep. But that doesn't matter. peace is the gift of God, not connected with any of these things. Peace, perhaps God may not answer your prayers, but what Bible says, be careful for nothing, but by prayer and supplication let your request be made known unto God, and the peace of God that passeth all understanding shall keep or garrison your hearts. So Bible doesn't say when you pray God will answer your prayer. Be careful for nothing, but for everything by prayer and supplication let your request be made known unto God. And when we do that, what God will do? The peace that passeth all understanding He will give. He doesn't say God will answer the prayer, no. Whatever the peace we need, that is, sometimes God may answer our prayer, but that can bring problem, more problem for us. And if God answers some of our prayers, we will have more confusion. So, what does God do? Instead of answering all our prayers, what does God do? God will give us peace and say, my child, I will take care of it. Leave it to me. Yes, my child, I know that is not needed for you. So I am not going to give you. But I will give my peace. So peace is the gift of God which can be kept in a pure conscience. So here we find Joseph has taught these people about it. They were able to speak. Of course, this steward, he did not know these brethren are Joseph's brethren. No. Later only they came to know. But they were able to speak about heavenly peace. So, what we need to have is that in our life, make sure always we have peace. When you go to bed, before you go to bed, if you don't have peace, examine your heart and see what is the problem. It is not tomorrow somebody is going to kill you or shoot you. That is not the problem. Peace, that when God is in the inmost of our being, there is peace. Anyway, there are few more things to learn, so I don't want to go into that much. But before I close, turn from that verse, I want to mention to you too. If we need to have peace, one thing that we should know God. That is why Paul says that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of sufferings, etc., etc., that I count all things but dung for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord. So to know God, when we know God, what we have? Not only we have peace, peace and grace multiply. If today you have got 10 points of peace, it multiplies 10 into 10, 100. And then 100 into 100, 10,000. And then 10,000, maybe a million. So, the more we know God, the more we read that verse. Somebody can read 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 2. That is why we encourage people, the time that you spend so much, whether on radio or television or newspaper or social visits or so many other entertainments and picnics and various, so many times, the time that you spend, at least part of that time, if you can spend with God to know Him, what you will get? Something the world cannot give you. Peace and grace. Not only God will give peace and grace will be multiplied. Please read it again loudly.
Grace and peace be multiplied unto you.
See, grace and peace be multiplied unto you. How?
Through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord.
Praise God. Now the world is hunting for peace. Where can I find peace? If you go to a superstore and ask for a pound of peace, they will laugh at you. They will say, we also don't have that. And so, how do we get peace and grace? And peace and grace multiplied through the knowledge of God and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That is why Paul spent all his life, what for? to know God. Actually, there was no human being, I would say, during that time who knew God in such a personal way, in a deeper way, other than Paul. That Paul says, I want to know him more. Dear children of God, the more we know him, we want to know anything in the world. I am determined that I will know only Christ and him crucified. He always almost appeared to be a madman. That is why the governor Felix told, much education made him, or Paul, much education has made you mad. He thought that Paul had become mad because he was so mad after God. We need such St. Pauls even now also. In this America, you have so much, you can learn so much. You have so much to understand. So much of programs come. So much of economic or technological advances, medical advances, and so many things we can learn. But one thing people neglect, schools neglect, universities neglect, the way of peace and grace. Let's close our eyes. Before we go to the next, I myself have to say, I need to have a greater hunger and thirst for God and for God's word. If you and I have been neglecting the word of God, the reason is that we don't have a hunger and thirst to know God. Let's praise God that God may put an insatiable thirst and a great hunger to know God, so that peace and grace may multiply, so that we will be able to share this peace and joy with others, so that we will be able to decide like St. Paul, I have determined, I want to know nothing other than Jesus and him crucified. For helping us, shall we all praise God? Praise you, O Father. Lord, praise you, O God. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, O Father. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Oh, deeper yet I pray. Everyone, oh, deeper yet I pray, every day, once again, all together, oh, deeper yet I pray. Dear children of God, when this wisdom, when this knowledge, when we seek after, as James says, wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated. I request all of you, spend more time with God. Spend more time in reading the Word of God. And seeking, not just reading, diligently searching. There are so many beautiful truths, as David says, Lord, open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of thy word. When we know God, our life will be really different. As Daniel says, they that know God will be strong, and they shall do exploits. Now, before we go to the next verse, here the steward says, peace be to you, fear not, your God and the God of your father hath given you treasure in your sacks. I hope you will remember last studies. As soon as they opened the sacks, what happened to them when they saw the money? They had heart attack. Their heart fainted. Somehow they survived. They were in great trouble. As soon as they saw the money in the sack, they were greatly troubled. Now what does the steward say? In your sack it was not trouble. What was in your sack? It was treasure in your sack. But you thought it was trouble in your sack. I told you the meaning of sack some time ago. Anybody remembers? Eh? Sack. Anybody remembers the meaning of sack? Eh? Our lives. So, this is very true about us also sometimes, you know. Some of the things that we think in our lives, some troubles, what are they indeed? They are indeed, they are treasures. Unless God opens our spiritual eyes, we don't understand. Many of our troubles are our treasures given by Joseph. Our Joseph doesn't give any trouble for us. But we, our guilty conscience, take it as trouble. And sometimes we imagine they are our troubles. But a time will come, we will realize they are really treasures given by Him. And then the 26th verse will come to. Somebody may read the 26th verse. Here, again they are bowing their heads to the earth. Now do you know why they are bowing their heads? Earlier they were bowing their heads to get the corn. They came from a famine-stricken country. They wanted to get corn. Some people worship Jesus also. They want some material blessings. They want, quite a number of people come to the Lord also, or pray, asking for prayer, or coming to church because sometimes they may need some physical healing. Sometimes they may need some, they may have some other problems to solve the problems. So these people also came, and first they bowed their heads to the governor without realizing it was Joseph. They wanted to get corn. Now can you imagine why, can you guess why they are bowing? They are scared. Why? They are thinking that they are going to, this governor is going to take us as bondmen, and they are going to, he is going to take our donkeys away. So they are bowing. Some people do this also. I know about a lady in one church. She was coming to church. She told me, Pastor, I am coming to church because if I don't come to church, I am afraid whether Jesus will kill my husband. That is why I am coming to church. So what a fear it is, and what a wonderful understanding some people have got about Jesus. That is till we get till our heart is right with God, we will never get a clear revelation, a proper revelation about Jesus. When I was in the nominal church, we had some feasts. There we have to give some offerings, say